Namaste. So here we are with another episode, the 11th ślokam of the Śrī Śiva-sahasranāmam. Now, if you think that I'm just playing around with this old scripture and, you know, going through the motions or reading from the book, and that it's basically a formal exercise in worship or something like that, no, you're missing. This is not boring, right? This is rather the cause of higher realizations. And I would use the example that just like formal temple worship and formal study of scriptures and stuff like that leads to spontaneous bhakti, right? Performance of rituals in karma yoga leads to spontaneous love of God in bhakti yoga. And when bhakti yoga, especially to the mother, especially to the goddess, when bhakti yoga matures, it becomes dhyana, it becomes meditation, raja yoga. So the worship of Shiva is already raja yoga, because Shiva, as we have pointed out in our series, Dreamtime, is Sushupti. He is the origin. He is the cause. He is not caused by anything else. He's Sarva Karana Karanam, the cause of all causes. This is Sushupti. So, you know, if you study the functional aspects of the worship, you find that the concentrating on a sound vibration of a certain quality, that which has no referent within the material creation, leads to advancement of consciousness, ultimately leads to realization of Brahman. And Brahman is the highest, Turiya, the highest consciousness, and also the unconditioned. There's nothing happening in Brahman. There's no identity, no separate I, no individuality, no action, no knowledge, not even consciousness. Brahman is pure awareness. And we're going to be getting deep into this in a new series coming up soon on the Katha Upanishad. Katha Upanishad is very deep. So running in parallel with Shiva's thousand names, we're going to have a very potent program here on the Shiva Duty channel. So let's take a look at verse 11.
Aum Vishalaksho Mrigavadhya Suresha Suryatapanaha Dharma Dhamma Kshamakshetrang Bhagavan Bhaganetra Bihit.
Vishalaksha means wide-eyed, huh? His eyes are open. He is aware. He sees everything. He knows everything. He is unlimitedly conscious, unlimitedly aware, and able to interfere or guide, let's say, the activities of the living beings by offering them intuitions. This is what comes from Sushupti. See, dreams. There's a certain quality of dreams. Most dreams are simply digesting the day's impressions, the experiences, the sensory experiences of the world prior to going into Sushupti. But when coming out from Sushupti into dream consciousness, Svapna, one experiences a certain type of dreams that can only be termed intuitive, intuition, revelation. So if you're into developing dream consciousness, controlling your dreams, lucid dreaming, and like that, then this will be obvious to you, that there are dreams that contain elements of our conscious waking experience and are familiar, and then there are dreams that are like out of left field. They contain new knowledge and material that we have never experienced before. And as an artist, I learned over many years that if you follow your intuition, if you follow your inspiration, you get more. Shiva sees, oh, he's listening. And so he responds by giving more insight, more revelations, more deep thoughts that you could never come to on your own, sometimes through the scriptures and sometimes just spontaneously. Insight is a wonderful experience. So anyway, Vishalaksha. You can also be Vishalaksha if you're aware of all these things of consciousness. Next, Mrigavyada. Mrigavyada means hunter of the animals. Huh? Well, we often see Shiva in the guise of a hunter, wearing an animal skin, carrying various weapons and so on. I have a theory that the original human beings, what we maybe call Neanderthals or something like that, were actually superior, not inferior, not something that we evolved out of into some superior state, but they were bigger, stronger, longer lived, smarter, more spiritual, etc., etc. And we see their dim echoes in the extraordinary knowledge and endurance of tribal peoples like the Aborigines in Australia and the Native Americans. These early humans were so strong that they could live naked in the woods, like Shiva. And they probably hunted and also lived on subsistence agriculture. Now, who today could go and live naked in the woods and on top of that, perform meditation and austerities leading to self-realization? Huh? Who of us could do that? Even in a mild climate like Sri Lanka, we'd get eaten up by mosquitoes and sunburned and all kinds of things. So these were people of a different stripe, of a different quality, and they have almost disappeared. Now and then you get a rare sighting of a yeti. And the Sanskrit word is yati. Yati means someone who lives in the woods, basically without any kind of support, just natural. And these were the people who brought the Vedas, who brought the knowledge that now underpins the foundation of Vedic society, which is really the only civilization on this planet. So, Suresha. Suresha means the Lord of Gods. Sura means a pious person. And of course, the most pious are the gods, the demigods, like Indra and like that. And Isha, again, means the first, the Lord, the God. So Sura plus Isha becomes Suresha by Sandhi, the combination of words. Surya Tapanaha. Tapaha means austerity. It means, burning, fire. Because fire is purifying. And when we perform austerity, this is voluntary suffering for spiritual advancement. We're taking our karma, which is coming anyway, we're going to suffer anyway, but we're taking it by our own will, deliberately, instead of accidentally by force of nature. And so it doesn't affect us as much, but it leads to spiritual advancement and ultimate freedom from karma. So Surya Tapanaha, in some forms of austerity, one sits out in the sun naked and allows themselves to be burned by the sun, sometimes even surrounded by fires. I mean, really, really tough austerities described in the Vedas. Again, who could do that today, you know? It's really hard. But anyway, Today we have austerities like japa and brahmacharya, you know, living celibate, and so many other austerities, eating vegetarian food, maybe eating only once a day, you know, different forms of austerities that we can perform. And so he is so strong, he is so powerful that he can burn even the sun, that even the sun has to perform austerities to realize him, to please him. That's the quality, or that's the position, or the potency of Shiva. Dharma Dham. Dhamma means a residence. So he is the residence of Dharma, righteousness, purity, truth, right action, compassion, understanding, wisdom. Dharma means all these things. Fundamentally, it means what is, the way it is, and why it is the way it is. That's my own interpretation of Dharma. That if you know these things, if you know what really is, as opposed to the illusion of what most people dream they're seeing, if you see what actually is, you realize everything is consciousness. And then why it is the way it is. See, that this is the way it is, right? That everything is consciousness. Everything is derived from consciousness. All experience is consciousness, and so on. So the four states of consciousness and their interactions, which we've been discussing in detail on this channel, lead to all kinds of experiences. But if we see that all experiences, without any qualification, all experiences, all conscious experiences are actually illusion, then we only identify with the conscious self as the I, as the being. Then we're seeing things as they are. We're seeing what is. And how it is that the world is illusion, consciousness is real. In other words, you're not your body, you're not your mind, you're not your experiences or your memories, what to speak of your designations, names, titles, and forms, and so on. You're not any of that. You are the consciousness that is aware of that. So then, Dhamma, he lives in Dharma, or Dharma lives in him. He is the container of everything. See? Everything, especially having to do with truth and self-realization. Then kshama kshetra. Kshama means compassion, especially forgiveness. Forgiveness is the greatest compassion. So he is kshetra, the field of such compassion, such mercy. And this is my experience in dealing with Shiva also, that with just a little devotional service, he grants forgiveness from so many things. He just forgets about it as if it didn't happen. So it's like canceling all your stupid desires and all your wrong ideas and all of your wrong ways of looking at the world and so on. He just cancels them and says, okay, this is Dharma. This is the way it really is. And then you get to know the truth. And what is that? Shiva is Bhagavan. Bhagavan means the fortunate one. He is one whose desires are always satisfied. Therefore, you can say he has no desire because all his desires are automatically satisfied. That's Shiva. Devi is anticipating his desires. She is such a perfect companion, such a perfect disciple, such a perfect mate and wife that she anticipates his desires. He doesn't have to ask anything from her. She automatically knows and supplies it even without his asking. So he's Bhagavan. And when we realize him, we become Bhagavan. Shivoham, Shivoham. Finally, Bhaga Netrabhit. Bhaga means Bhaga, one of the associates of Daksha. And Netrabhit means he split or plucked out his eyes. And the story is, during the sacrifice of Daksha, the doomed sacrifice, where he didn't invite Lord Shiva, and Sati gave up her life by a yogic fire, Shiva was so angry, he came and he manifested a great hero, a great demon, who simply destroyed everything and defeated all the demigods, chased everyone away, killed a bunch of people and stuff. And during the sacrifice, when Daksha was, you know, gloating over the fact that he didn't invite Lord Shiva, this Bhaga looked at Daksha with a certain look in his eyes, like, yeah, cool, man, you know. And so Virabhadra, the demon created by Shiva, plucked out his eyes. Virabhadra, of course, is only the Shivanga, the limb of Shiva. So with one limb, with one finger of his potency, Shiva defeated all the demigods, including Vishnu. Vishnu and Brahma were scattered. They were all, even Indra. None of them could face Virabhadra. And Virabhadra is only a small part of the potencies of Shiva, who is all victorious, all fortunate, Bhagavan. Aum Tat Sat. Aum Shakti Aum. Aum Namah Shivaya.